Alrighty, today we're going to talk about Unit 10.2 in our Calculus BC series. We are talking about sequences and calculus now, so we're going to start tying in just a little bit of the calculus. Mainly today we're really just going to be talking about a little bit of limits. So first we're going to start with an arithmetic sequence. So the information that's important from this, I'm going to break it down for you. So the first thing you want to do is find your common difference, that's that D value. Then you want to plug in your information into the recursive equation. This is your recursive equation. It's on your packet. Then you want to plug in your information into your explicit equation. Of course, somewhere in between all of this, you would have solved for whatever they're asking for. The nth term, the 20th term, the 9th term, whatever it is they're searching for. And then, of course, you also want an explicit equation. Now, this isn't necessarily something I gave to you, but I think that it is important that we can see this. You can always get the proof from recursive to explicit, but I kind of gave you an equation to work with. So let's look at a problem. Let's look at example 1a. So the four things we're going to be searching for are 1, the common difference, 2, the 9th term, 3, the recursive rule, and 4, the explicit rule. So here is our sequence. So the first thing I'm going to do is look at, the first thing they're asking me to find is my common difference. So let's look at that. Well, that's pretty simple, right? This is arithmetic, so we're just trying to figure out what value is between these. What is the difference between them? So the simplest form I can do is just negative 5 plus something must equal negative 2. And we solve for x. If I want to triple check, I can just plug in my value. So if I plugged in negative 2 and added my value of 3, does it equal that? Yeah, so we're good there. Well, let's try it again. 1 plus 3, does that equal the next number in my sequence? Cool. So my D value, my common difference, is probably 3. The second thing they're asking us to do is figure out our 9th term. Well, with the information they've given us, can I figure that 9th term out pretty easily? Yeah, I could probably just plus and plus and plus, but let's try a little bit something different. Let's try something else. So let's come back to this. Yes, I could have just put plus 3, plus 3, plus 3, and gotten to my 9th term, but what if it's more complicated than that? So I'm going to go ahead and skip this step, and I'm going to move on to step 3, which is asking us to use our recursive rule. That is a formula you just have to memorize, but here it is again for you. So I plug those values, I plug in my D value, and guess what? That's all I had to do for my recursive rule. That's all we got to do, but we still haven't answered number 2. So let's go ahead and move on to 4 and get our explicit rule. And getting our explicit rule is really what's going to help us solve any nth term. So I plug in my my explicit formula. I know A1 because that's given to me in my sequence. I also know D because I solved for that already. So from here, we just do a quick algebra, distribute that 3, and there we go. I now have my explicit formula. Well, guess what? Using this explicit formula, I can go back to question 2 and figure out our 9th term. So I use my explicit formula, I find a(9), and I plug that in, and boom, I get 19. Yes, again, we could have just done 7 and 3 is 10, 10 and 3 is 13, 13 and 3 is 16, 16 and 3 is 19, and boom, we got our 9th form. But again, I remind you, this is a simple sequence. What happens if it's more complicated? This is the pattern you want to follow if it is more complicated. Let's look at another. Here's our wrap up, all 4 questions answered. And let's look at another one. Here is where things get complicated. Looking at this inherently, we may not be able to figure things out super simply. So again, we just want to follow the same pattern. I will remind you that if you don't know your natural log properties, your exponent properties, and your natural base properties, you will struggle a little bit with some of these rewrites because these are pretty similar to example questions that you would see in an AP test, or at least concepts, you know? So first thing they're asking for is the common difference. So again, I'm just going to figure out what's the difference. Ln of 2 plus some value is going to equal ln of 6. Well, to find that, all I do is subtract ln of 2. There's my natural log rule that tells me if I'm subtracting 2 lns, I can put that as my difference. And from there, I simplify to ln of 3. I can test out these values. So let's do ln of 6 plus ln of 3. Well, again, there's another Oh, I lost my train of thought. There's another ln property, says when I add them, I can multiply, right? So that becomes ln of 18. That's what we've got, so cool, we're good there. I continue on, I double check. Awesome, we're good there. So my D is probably ln of 3. Again, here, if I really wanted to, since this is an arithmetic sequence, I could have just continued on in this sequence to get my ninth term. But to save myself some time, I already have to answer step 3 and step 4. I have to do that anyway. So why waste my time if I'm going to get a formula for it? So we're going to go ahead and skip our way to number 3. Question 3 is asking us for a recursive rule. So I plug that into that formula. I've given it to you again. We know D, so that's all we have to do. Then we move on to step 4, our explicit rule. This is usually the hardest rule. I plug it into that formula. I know A1, it's given to me. I also know D, so I can plug those in. Again, I distribute, and I rearranged a little bit this negative ln I brought here because I can use my ln property of differences in division. And I'm also going to use my exponent rule with my ln. This n can be moved up. It's an ln property as well. And that gives me this. Again, I have another property here. If they're added, I can just multiply them. And then from there, I get the difference quotient, or this final form, which is another exponent property in here. Okay, going back, we're going to go back to question 2, and I'm going to use this formula I now have, and I'm going to use it to find my, what are we looking for, ninth term. So I'm going to look for the ninth term and plug this in. That becomes 3 to the 8th. We can solve that, and that multiplied by 2 becomes 13,122. Of course, if I had left it like this, that would have also been the correct answer. Here's our wrap-up, summary of all 4 questions that we answered. Okay, let's move on to example 2. We're talking about geometric sequences this time. Again, all this information, I'll break it down for you. So the first thing you want to do now is find a common ratio. So we're no longer talking about the differences between my terms and my sequence. Now we're talking about the ratio. So what do I have to multiply by to get the next next term in my sequence? Then you're going to plug in your information to the recursive equation, which is given to you in your packet. And then you want to plug it into the explicit equation, which I didn't give to you, but I gave it to you right here if you want to copy it, just like with arithmetic. So here we go again. So now we're looking for, one, the common ratio, a little bit different. Now we're also looking for the 10th term, tiny bit different. But we're still looking for the recursive rule and the explicit rule. So we'll start with number 1 because we need that. We need to find a common ratio. So I'm going to ask myself, what is the ratio between 1 and negative 2? So what times 1 is going to equal negative 2? That one's really easy. My x is going to be negative 2. I can test it out. Negative 2 times negative 2, does it equal 4? Is that the next one in my sequence? Cool, we're good there. Then I'm going to do 4 times negative 2, and does that equal my next value in the sequence? Awesome. So our r is probably going to be negative 2. Number 2, again, yeah, I could sit there and do every term and find the 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th, and then 10th term, but let's go ahead and skip it and move to question 3 and find our recursive rule and our explicit rule and go back, just like we've been doing. So here's our recursive rule formula. I plugged in my R, and that's all we really needed. So let's move on to our explicit. Here's that formula. Well, now, where's A1? It's in my sequence. Where's R? I already solved for it, so I plug that in. Here we can distribute a little bit in this instance. Anything times 1 is just going to be itself, so we're good there. And there is our explicit formula. So I'm going to go back to question 2 and plug in my explicit formula for n of equals 10, and I get negative 2 to the 9th, which is going to be negative 512. Again, if I had left it in this form, that's still the correct answer. Here's our recap. All 4 questions are answered. Let's move on to example 2B. Woo, this one looks kind of funky. But again, just follow your steps. Don't even stress about it, and you will get to the right point. So question 1, what's my common ratio? So what times 10 to the negative 2 is going to equal 10 to the negative 1? Well, if I had to do this in my head or on a piece of paper without a calculator or anything like that, this is a pretty simple question. I should be able to do this without a calculator because this is just saying 1 over 10 squared. 1 over 10. That's all that negative exponent tells me. So what times that? Well, If I bring it over, it simply becomes x equals 10. I can double check, and boom, that is my next number in my sequence, and that is my next number in my sequence. Again, we're gonna skip, so r is 10. Again, we're gonna skip question two, move straight into three, and talk about our recursive rule. Do I know r? I sure do. Plug it in, boom, there's my recursive rule. What about explicit? Here's that formula. Do I know a1? I sure do. It's in there for me. Do I know r? I absolutely do. And now here we have to do a little bit of algebraic manipulation to get a more appropriate form of this. But again, you really could have just used this. That's fine. But I did a little bit of algebraic manipulation, my exponent rule. Because my bases are the same as 10, if I multiply exponents, I'm just adding them. So I added them, simplify that, and I actually get 10 to the n minus 3. This is a significantly easier equation to use than this, but again, it's all the same. You can use them. Go back to question two. I'm gonna plug in this new equation, but now we're looking for the 10th term. So I'm gonna do 10 minus 3, which is just 10 to the 7th. Again, this is the acceptable answer as well as your 7 zeros. Moving on, here's a recap, but moving on, let's talk about constructing sequences. So what happens when they don't give you the sequence itself? What happens if they just give you a little bit of information? Well, I gave you an example problem like this, and we're gonna see it, but these are basically just word problems. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna break them down like we normally do. How do we break down a word problem? Well, we identify our givens, and sometimes we have to sketch a graph, not necessarily in a sequence, but I'm just reminding you. Label appropriately, identify what we're searching for, and then plug away, right? That's basically what we do with word problems. So here's our word problem, the second and fifth, yada, yada, yada. You can read it. So let's go ahead and identify our givens. So we see that the second term is gonna be equal to 6. The fifth term is gonna be equal to negative 58. We are looking for the first term, so that's one of our searches. We are also looking for the common ratio, so what is r? And we are searching for our explicit rule, so a of n, but the explicit and not the recursive, and that's what we're searching for. So let's go ahead and start with our 1, 2, and 3. Let's begin with 1, and this is asking for our first term. Well, to solve 1, we're probably going to have to do some more information, so we're going to skip it. Let's go ahead and move on to 2, the common ratio. This is probably where you should always start, the common ratio. So what is that information we have? Well, we know that the second term and the fifth term, we know those. So let's go ahead and plug those in. We know that, where is it? There it is. A of 2 is going to be equal to A of 1 times R. That's our recursive, right? A n minus 1. And so on and so forth. A of 3 would also, in this instance, A of 3 would have been equal to A of 2 times R. But this is a geometric sequence. So that's the same thing as saying A of 1 times R squared. Think about the relationship between these two numbers if you actually plugged in real values. So we can continue on that pattern. A of 4 would just be R cubed, and A of 5 would be R to the fifth. Well, why did I fill out that information? Why did I create that pattern? Because we know that 6 is going to be equal to that A of 2, which is going to actually now be equal to A1 times R. We know negative 48 is equal to A1 times R to the fourth. Well, now I have basically a system of equations here. So we're looking for a ratio, so let's make it a ratio. So I just create a ratio, and I'm just going to plug away. So I can cancel out the A1s, we know that. I can also cancel out one R on top and one on bottom. And that gives me 1 over R cubed is equal to 1 over negative 8. I'm just gonna flip them, make it a little easier on myself. And the cube root of 8 we know is negative 2. So now I know my R. Can I go back and figure out question 1? Absolutely. So there's my recursive formula. And I plug in A of 2, because we've got to solve for A of 1 first. A of 2 I know is equal to 6. So I just solve away and I know A1 is now equal to negative 3. Using that, I can now find my explicit rule. I now know the first term, I now know R, so that's how I'm gonna find my explicit rule. Plug in the values I just solved for, simplify, so from here to here, these are the same thing, but this is just the simplification of exponents, this is exponent properties. If you are struggling with exponent properties, you can always come see me. Okay, and that's it, we did that. Yay, we constructed a sequence. Okay, but what happens if we have to graph a sequence? Okay, let's say you're given information, and the only way to figure out some stuff, which we'll see in the next section actually, the only way to figure it out is to graph it. Well, how do I use it? You guys have the TI Inspire. So let's talk about it with the TI Inspire. We're going to be looking at example 4A and 4B. So let's start with 4A. This is what I'm given. So if I'm doing the TI Inspire, then I'm gonna wanna go to a graph. And then from there, I'm gonna wanna change how I enter my information. So I go to Menu, Graph Entry Edit, so Menu 3, and then Sequence. So Menu 3-7, and then Sequence again. Menu 3-7-1. I'm gonna plug in, just like it shows you here, that information. So I put -1 to the end, times the entire quantity of n minus 1 over n. My initial term was 1, because it tells me n equals 1. And I didn't change these 1 to 99 values. Sometimes you might have to zoom in, zoom out kind of thing. And the step, I just said step by 1. That's fine. I hit enter, and I get something that's going to look like this. Well, I can't really visualize what's happening, so I'm going to go ahead and zoom out. So I'm going to go to window, and instead of zooming out or in or putting window setting, I'm just going to hit zoom fit and let the calculator decide what's the best use for me. And boom, I get something that looks like this. This is this sequence graphed, okay? But from here, what information do I need to graph it? Well, I probably need points, so that's pretty easy. I go to graph trace, so menu 5-1, and now I can figure out any point, and it gives it to me right here. So this is the 0.74, 0.986. Using graph trace later will actually also show us what these values are approaching. Here's example 4B. Ooh, that one looks crazy. So previously we had a recursive and now we have an explicit. So how do we deal with this? What do we do? Well, it's pretty similar. We go to the graph, we enter it in as a sequence, but this time you're gonna have to hit this U1 button. How do I get there? I'm gonna hit the variable button, I think. The variable button, which is the button directly above 9. I don't know if you can see it, but I'm hoping you can. But it's gonna be your button directly above 9, and that's gonna give me some options. And I'm gonna select U of 1, and that's gonna give me the option to do U of 1 of n minus 1. This is the same as saying B of n minus 1. That's basically what we're putting here in calculator form. And then plus 2. It asks me for the initial term. It says B of 1 is 4, so that's my initial term. I know that this one's kind of a zoomed in one, so I went ahead and changed this to 1 is less than or equal to n is less than or equal to 30. I still set a step of 1. I graphed it, and ooh, I got a blank graph. Well, it's probably not wrong. There was no syntax error, so I'm going to go ahead and just zoom out and see what happens. So I went to my window zoom fit, and boom, I actually got it back. So look at that. Looks pretty good now. This is my sequence graph, and again, if I go to graph trace, I can pull up those values. So here is 27 and 56, and then I think I toggled back and forth to kind of show you guys some different values, okay? But how does graphing help us? Well, graphing helps us determine convergence and divergence. To do this, we need to find the limit of our sequences, and here's the calculus part of today. So the first thing you're gonna do, of course, is graph it. You're gonna analyze it, and then you're going to identify your unique finite number, if there is one. If there is a unique finite number, then that means your limit exists, and you're gonna write your limit. If there isn't a unique finite number, then you're probably gonna write that the sequence diverges, because it can't converge. Here's some information about limit of a sequence. This is in your packet at the very front. Okay, here's example 5A. Now this is not a sequence we've seen yet, so we're gonna have to go ahead and graph it. I did that for us and plugged in this information. If you wanted to copy it, I've got it here for you. And boom, there it is. I think I had to zoom fit it, but I already did that step for you. And of course, I'm going to graph trace to kind of see what y value am I approaching. It looks like I'm approaching approximately 2, yeah, 1.96, 1.98, probably reaching 2, which is cool. But what do we do next? Well, since it's approaching a unique finite number, we can figure out our limit. This is a proof about the limit. So the limit of my sequence, okay, here's my limit property. This is not a limit property, this is my fraction property. And then I can simplify it. And here's my limit property, I can pull it apart. Well, the limit as n approaches infinity of 2 is simply 2, and the limit as n approaches infinity of 1 over n, so 1 over infinity, so a giant number on bottom, bigger on bottom, it's going to be 0, right? My Bobo rule. So 2 minus 0 is just 2. Well, there's proof. I saw it in my graph that my sequence approached 2. I also see it if I test the limit itself that it equals 2. So my sequence must converge. And this is my end answer. My sequence converges because the limit as n approaches infinity of the sequence is equal to 2. Here's another example, and oh, look at that. Isn't that nice? That's what we did in example 4a. That was our graph before. So I'm just gonna pull that graph back up. What do we have to do? We're gonna look at what's happening. So I'm approaching up here a value of about 1, and I'm approaching down here a value of about negative 1. Well, they're approaching numbers, single numbers, they're not approaching infinity or anything, but does that mean it's converging? 1, negative 1. Are those unique finite numbers? No, it's 2 unique finite numbers. That doesn't help us. So this sequence must diverge. It did not approach a unique finite number. It approaches 2 finite numbers. Here's our other one. Again, same graph we used before. So here's my graph, and where am I approaching? I'm approaching here, and I'm approaching here. What do we call those? Those are our infinities, so I'm approaching infinity. That's not a unique finite number, so my sequence still diverges, but of course with this one we could write that the limit of my sequence is approaching infinity is equal to 0, but it would also show us that it was diverging. Our final thing we're going to talk about is our squeeze theorem and the absolute value theorem. This simply comes from, this is a proof that is developed because of the squeeze theorem. So you don't have to really understand the proof behind it, you just have to know that your information, that if you're taking the absolute value of your sequence, it's still gonna just be equal to the limit of that sequence. So squeeze theorem, this is a slightly confusing concept. I highly recommend that you watch a few other videos out there. Simply Google the phrase squeeze theorem of sequences. Don't just Google squeeze theorem, that'll give you basic calculus squeeze theorem. You want squeeze theorem for sequences, okay? So we're gonna use the squeeze theorem to show that the sequence cosine n over n converges and finds its limit. So of course, if I originally started with the limit as x approaches 0, then what's gonna happen? I'm gonna get an indeterminate form. I'm gonna get 0 over 0. So, 1 over 0, which still undefined. So what do I do? Well, I'm gonna look at it as piece by piece, and what we're gonna say is, just look at that top portion and what happens? Well, you know that cosine has to be less than or equal to 1. It's never gonna be greater. The absolute value at least won't be greater. And so what we can do is we can split it up. This is our squeeze theorem that tells me here's my here's my sequence, and here is a left side and a right side, and all we're gonna do is say if the left and the right are equal, then the middle must be the same value. So we're just gonna simplify down, and we know that the limit of -1 over n, this should have been 1 over n, my apologies. And those are both 0, so then the limit of the middle is gonna be 0. Cool. And that's all we've got for today. Again, if this one confused you, it is kind of a tough concept. If this one confused you, please just Google another video. Alrighty, thank you so much, and we'll see you at 10.3.